I should have higher frequency, which result according to the to this relation with lower wavelengths. And according to Fresnel zone, the minimum feature that can be seen should be greater than lambda divided by 4. Okay? So our intention in this case is to make lambda smaller as possible to see or to identify small features. Okay? This occurs when we use higher frequencies. When you use higher frequency, higher frequencies, it results in higher sample rate. No, okay. Yesterday we gave example. You remember Nyquist frequency? So it is a maximum frequency that can represent that can be represented by the sample rate. So here, if I'm going to increase frequency, I should increase also the sample rate. Do you have any objection? So suppose I'm making sampling rate for Nyquist frequency equal 50 hertz. So if I'm going to increase this frequency to more than 50 hertz, I have to increase the sample rate. Is it clear? Okay. Now we go to review. Luckily, we have this again. To anti-alias filter. Now, this one, excuse me, if you have any comments, any discussion, any question, please give it to me. Okay? So this one represents the original signal. This signal, when digitized at larger sample interval, it results in this one, the broader one. As you see, the broader one does not similar, does not give any identification and the identification related to the original one. So we call this aliasing, and it's total loss of the energy we are looking for. So if we didn't take care about aliasing, then we end up with nonsense at the end. So at some time when somebody is set or committed this big sin, he is not only spelled out or fired out from the company, no, he will not enter any oil company again, because this is a trivial mistake. So what is the Nyquist frequency? In order to recover all Fourier components of a periodic waveform, it's necessary to use the sample rate at least twice the highest waveform frequency. And this is represented here. Yesterday, this signal can be digitized significantly using two points, one here and the other here. Thus, this definition means the sample rate should be at least twice the highest waveform frequency we are trying to represent in our sampling, because each cycle requires at least 2 points to be sampled. The relation is here f inequest equal 1 divided by 2 times delta t, where delta t is a sample interval. And here we have a small question, and I will in future lecture put some questions that can be for training and maybe be part of the final exam or the test. So we should take care and we should try to answer these questions. So how the anti-alias filter looks like? The anti-alias filter looks like this. Here is the Nyquist frequency. We are looking for applying this frequency, this filter, to keep data here at the pass band, which is lower than the Nyquist frequency, and removing the other at the stop band that above the Nyquist frequency. And also, those spectra, those alias spectra that result from the digitization phenomena itself. However, this is the ideal case. You studied filter design before, so this cannot be done in reality. And if we suppose this occur, we end up with the so-called Gibbs phenomena. There is some energy leaked into the data that is virtual, it's not real one. But however, this is a real case for anti-alias filter. This transition might be narrower or broader, depending on the sample rate we are using. So in this case, it doesn't mean that we are going to have 100 samples per second, that we should use 50 hertz, because this is the ideal case that we cannot achieve. So we should give some limit so that to increase the sample rate so that we have this zone for removing or reducing the amplitude of unwanted signal. So this question is, anti-alias filter is low pass filter, band pass filter, or high pass filter? It's high pass filter? Yes. It's low pass filter. I want you to take care of the terminology. Here, low pass, band pass, and high pass, okay? Means to let it go. It here, low pass means it lets lower energy to pass. Here, banded between F1 and F2, and then between, it lets the higher frequency to pass. Other terminology, it might be as low cut and high cut and band pass cut, which means here is the reverse. Low cut means I am cutting out the low frequency. Here I am cutting out the higher frequency. And in band pass or band cut means I am taking part of the energy away from, which is subtended by two frequency, F1 and F2. So take care in multiple choice. Usually we play some with the terminology so that it's not clear. If it's so clear, so it's simple for you to answer. So it's, you know, examination means like sieves, you know, sieves? Sieve. Not thief, sieve. Yes, sieve. Yes. So we brought you in the sieve and sample you. Some of you will be of lower grade, some with medium grade, some with higher or fine grade. So usually there must be some difficulty in the exams. Now we move to recording system. Any recording system is composed of three main parts. The sensor, the recording unit, and storage devices. These are the three main parts of the system. The sensor in land survey is called geophone, while in marine survey it's called hydrophone. Excuse me?
Hydrophone is placed on water.
Water, yes, yes. On land, yes. So you know hydro means water.
Excellent.
Yes. Excellent. So sensor is responsible for picking the vibration of the particle just beneath it and transforming this particle, this mechanical energy, into electric signal. The phenomena used for this transformation is either electromagnetic phenomena or the dynamo, you know the dynamo phenomena, or piezoelectric phenomena, which is the pressure phenomena. The one that uses piezoelectric phenomena is called transducer. You know, some crystals, when it's pressured, it produces electric signal. For example, cesium crystal. It's used for used in watches, and so very accurate watches used in scientific and the space applications. So the cesium crystal, when it is pressed, it produces electric current. And when it is left back, when it's dilatation or tensed, it also produces electric current. The direction of the electric current is reverse in both cases. Here is an electromagnetic sensor. Now you see this is the geophone, the spike, and this is the body of the geophone. The body of the geophone is composed of two main components. The first one is the magnet, and the second one is a coil. We have coil and the magnet. What happened when, suppose this is the geophone, and this is the ground, and the ground is moved upward in this direction. Here, there will be differential motion between the coil and the magnet. When a coil is moved between the two poles of the magnet, it cuts the flux. When it cuts the flux, an electric signal is generated in the coil. The amount of signal generated depends on the velocity and the distance of the motion of the coil or the magnet. In some instrument, the magnet is kept fixed and the coil is suspended, and in some other, the coil is kept fixed and the magnet is suspended. So this relative motion produces electric current. You studied electromagnetic before, and you know this is a dynamo effect. You know how the dynamo works?
Yes,
the dynamo, it's a coil that rotate between the poles of a magnet, this produce electric current. So this is the first part which produce electric signal, it transform mechanical signal into electric signal. This one, the transducers. Here, this is the body of the transducer, and the blue one, here is the crystal. When the pressure, suppose the ground is here, when it presses the crystal, electric current or electric signal is generated, and this electric signal generated is taken through wire to the recording instrument. The recording signal, the recording system is composed of mainly of these units. First, the sensor input the data into analog signal preparation. Here, in this stage, two operation occurs, the gain and the anti-alias filter. Then the signal is provided to the analog to digital converter, where the signal is digitized into samples, and then these samples move to digital signal processing, which is post-digitizing processing, how you want the data to be stored, if you want additional filtering to be applied at this stage. And then it is given here to the data management. Meanwhile, this is a time signal receiver. You know, in our seismic experiment, we usually have GPS with us. This GPS is not only responsible for providing me with latitude, longitude, and elevation, but also with the timing, especially for application other than seismic reflection or refraction. Suppose we are making experiment at longer distance for studying the crust, for example, then we are not working alone. We are working with other institutes. One of the most important thing is that to keep our timing system the same, because difference in time between us here and between other bodies out there means we have error, and this error will enter to our model, which will produce this may produce discontinuities or structures that never exist. So in some application, this point, this unit is very important. It's time signal receiver, which is then sent to clock time base. And this is the usual one used, a conventional one used, because we need timing with our sampled data. And then all this is sent to mass storage device. This part is related to the power supply of the system. Now we come to gain. Gain means the amplifier. You know amplifier, you know when you're listening to, for example, radio or TV or watching TV, or even you have MP4 and you want to listen to something. Sometimes you want to pop up the volume, or sometimes you want to lower down the volume. So the unit that is responsible for popping up the volume or lowering the volume is the amplifier. And that we need the amplifier because seismic energy is usually, especially those at longer distances and at deeper depths, are very weak, very small in energy, so that we need to increase the voice, to increase the volume, to pumping up the energy, so that we can see it and identify this weaker rivals to be clearly seen on our seismic cross section. Usually gain is expressed in units of decibel using this relation. It's equal 10 logarithmic to the base 10. This is the output signal divided by the input signals, and the unit is decibel. And this relation is used not only in seismic but in other, in radio, for example, and in other applications. You may hear this unit very often, the decibel. Okay. Why gain is applied in seismic recording? Because seismic signals are often weak, and thus we need to amplify its amplitude to be identified on seismic section. Other type of gain is called automatic gain control, and there is another one which is called time variant gain control. The energy of later arrivals and of arrivals coming from distant geophones are much more attenuated. If we applied the same gain, we'll end up with a section dominated by those energy coming from the near and shallow data or shallow seismic signal. So we use automatic or time varying control so that the amplification is not the same, it's not constant, it's increasing to some extent and then increasing back at longer time or longer distance. This is the, I will show you an example now. This is data taken by your colleagues. This pretty much looks like what we have in seismic reflection, but some other analysis and processing is applied to such record. So the green arrows here are responsible for the gain. So here I am increasing the gain. As you see, is it clear for you? As I'm increasing the gain, the later arrival, we start to see something, but the one at shallower depths and at near geophones become dominating and become harder to identify also. That's why we use the AGC or the automatic gain control. So we are applying the gain, not with constant value, but with variable value so that the output signal becomes more clearer. Okay? This is an example. This is this one before applying automatic gain control. And this one is after applying automatic gain control. It's evident that the energy here becomes more visible, especially at deeper depths, compared between these two sections. Also, another example here and more striking feature. Also, this is before applying the automatic gain control, and here is after applying the automatic gain control. You see the energy here is nearly missed here. Okay? So, gain plays important role in our seismic preparation and visualization. But also we must take care. Because using seismic method means I am applying either amplitude or time or both. In most of our applications, the ordinary or conventional applications, we are using time only. So in this case, applying time varying or frequency varying or distance varying gain is no problem, as I want to see the time of arrival of signals. But it affects amplitudes. So in case we are going to use the amplitudes, like in seismic attributes, this must be avoided, or at least it must be recoverable. Means at a certain time, if I want to get the real amplitude, I have the ability to do so. Okay, so I can remove in any time, I can remove the AGC or the time varying gain. Then we go to multiplexing and demultiplexing. Sometimes sometimes it is not known what is the importance of multiplexing and demultiplexing. Yes. Suppose I'm having, say, 100 or 1,000 trays, and this trace is sampled at 100 samples per second, and then I'm using a lot of data. This data requires huge media to store. So this problem is faced the surveyor or seismologist at earlier times. So they invented the multiplexing as a way to compress the data before storage, and then multiplexing, it's a way of uncompressing the data for the use. So we have the multiplexing, means combining multiple streams of information for transmission over shared medium. Demultiplexing performs the reverse function, which splits the combined stream arriving from a shared medium. It's a way of compressing the data using some logic or some logical functions to reduce the size. In earlier time, we used to have an example that if we do not use multiplexing, we need media, storage media, like at my age it was floppy disk, 1.4 megabytes. Sorry, 1.4, yes, 1.4 megabyte. So I need disks that if I put vertically, will reach to the Empire State elevation. So I have no space to save all this data together. So they invented multiplexing to compress the data and can be used in magnetic tape or any other media for further use. Then we apply demultiplexing to get the data back. This is a diagram. Here is the data sent to multiplexer, and all this data is compressed here for the shared medium. And then when I want to retrieve the data from here, I apply the multiplexer, and then the data can be used again. Okay, the compress, like RAR or other compressing, like other compressing softwares, you know, compress, WinRAR archives and some, okay? Thank you.